Guys, I'm Jeremy Evans. I work as a Java developer, mostly at Atlassian. Bit of full stack stuff, but yeah, developing. And I want to talk about how Atlassian does software development, what's different about that from what you learn at university, like how does industry and practice change of it, and how it's different to other courses. We also have some t-shirts and things here for anyone who survives through the end. You're keen for that. So I was going to go quickly, who am I, talk about Agile versus waterfall methods and what's taught and what's done in practice, then talk about how teams are structured in industry, then a few things about how Atlassian, what tools we use, how we structure that, and then finally some what's it like and more general questions. So who am I? As Alex mentioned, graduated in 2013, joined the grad program for Atlassian after that, started working for there, prior to regular developer since, and I'm currently working in our cloud experience department. Which what that means is we have a bunch of cloud products that we sell, and my team's trying to pull out all the different common functionality from each of those products and combine it into a single unified experience. So that includes like single sign-on efforts, it includes trying to make all of the product licensing management and account creation in one spot. So I quite like working there. It does sound fairly boring for doing parser policies and account creation, but it's very interesting trying to work with all different products and create experiences that are used by the administrators. Some of the best and worst of my career so far. Some of the best things I've really enjoyed are being able to build features from start to finish at Atlassian. They gave me, like they said, impersonation is one of them. Let's admins log in as another user. And I was designing that and built it from the very start, from sort of inception through to technical approaches through to actual code implementation. I've been able to fix things that affect customers. I've had emails from people saying, we have this huge problem, and it's been really good to be able to say, I've solved that for you. I actually really enjoy that feeling. And I've been given the freedom to improve the processes that we work with. So I wrote an application that tracks all of our automated builds and looks for any failures and looks at why they failed and creates a, we have like a wallboard TV with all of our stats and it shows how many tests failed, which percentage, why they're failing. So just things like that annoyed me. I was given the freedom to go through and fix all those, which I really like. Some of the worst things that have happened. So the first one, that is a hot incident ticket, which happened a few years ago now, so I think I can talk about it. When I joined Atlassian, my team had just released this unified administration and pulled it out of all the products. And I joined to an empty desk because we had created a huge security incident that was one of the biggest in company's history. My team had, and they were all working 24 hours just trying to fix it. So I thought I'd tell you a little bit about that one from a funny story point of view. But basically, when we had migrated, there was some lack of referential integrity. So we didn't delete old entries in the database and didn't know we had to check for those. So we made this brand new group, there were some old entries lying underneath, and suddenly everyone had permission to everything. And that was bad, and we solved it. Certainly memorable, I'll never forget that ticket. The other one was when I, Friday afternoon, decided to release some new code to production. I figured what's the worst thing that happened, it was a tiny change, and it broke everything. And I was called and the train had to come back in and help them roll back all of the failures. So those things were fun. Customers get cranky when they can't log in. So yeah, I guess, that past my career, I've been given freedom both to do things right and things badly. Okay, so we're going to talk about Agile versus Waterfall. So you may have seen this taught. I know it's the centerpiece of the software course at high school. I know it was taught here a little bit, where you go each of these distinct steps for developing software. I'd recommend you please don't do that. In general, like it's got some good theory behind it, but in practice doesn't seem to work. Originally, it was modeled as a way of not to do software development in the very first textbook slash paper it was released in. And even the US Department of Defense, one of the big organizations, has said, we do not want to hire people to use this process. Given it's usually sold as a, here is how you manage large software projects for big businesses, when the biggest and largest company says, please don't use it, kind of know something's wrong with it. Reasons why is, firstly, it assumes customers know what they want. In practice, this is very rarely true. They have an idea of what they currently do, and you offer some software solution that fixes it, and then they say, oh, actually, now can we change this, and now can we change this? And as they see features, they want more features, or they realize what they were doing was not optimal, and they can change it. And if you've, at the very start, done all of your planning based on their original idea, it's almost never what they actually wanted in practice. Another thing is it assumes engineers can estimate work accurately. Estimating software work is notoriously difficult. I think like 80% of projects run over time and over budget, and it's hard to predict those complications when you've got this really long-running 2-year time frame that's going to blow out. And there's no value to live until the end. So if you have a massive software project worth millions of dollars that takes 2 years, and invested a lot of money and seen no results, and given how fast our industry is moving, in 2 years what you built might be worthless. So you kind of need to be giving incremental value. Those are, to me, the biggest problems, but others will argue there's more. So the alternative is often presented as agile, which is kind of a very catchy term that encompasses a bunch of different methodologies, but particularly at how Atlassian does it, is firstly work in sprints, which is a key for saying 2 weeks worth of work. We commit to 2 weeks at a time. And at the end of each sprint, everyone has something to deliver. So something to show the customer. Might be a finished product, isn't perfect, but is at least something that you can start using and start getting feedback on. And we have to involve the customer as much as possible. In different places you work, that will be different. So for us, sometimes that's internal teams, sometimes it's customer feedback, either directly, like comments they leave on our website, or indirectly. We run experiments that track feature usage between different kinds of customers that can give us data back. Other places I've worked, they'd be direct. You'd sit down with the person who's funding the project and talk to them about how it's going. But you basically want to say, okay, here's the next 2 weeks worth of work, with the customer prioritize what you're going to do, and then work through that. And that way you never get this big shock at the end when everything's run over time, or when there's iterative features they want to change, that happens every 2 weeks as you're reevaluating, and they can see what's being produced. One of the key things about Agile is frequent short meetings. And there's a whole bunch that I want to go through that kind of make up this methodology, but the idea is rather than plan huge long periods of time, it's lots of short catch-ups to keep in sync. So the first one, which is probably the most common, is called a stand-up. So in most places with Agile, at the start of the day, everyone gathers together and just spends 5 minutes doing a quick highlight of their previous day. First thing is it's like 5 minutes max for a whole team. It's supposed to be a very short meeting, go through as quickly as you can. The objectives are, so for my team, we have a 30-second timer that we're timed to give our stand-up. Basically, what I am going to do today is my goal. Here's why I either didn't achieve my goal yesterday or what I did, and probably most importantly, here's what's blocking me. Here's what I'm stuck on. So the idea is if we go around and someone says, I'm working on this and I'm stuck on this, then by the end of it, I can say, oh, I have an idea of how to help you with that. Or someone can come to me and say, oh, you're working on that, that relates to my thing. So it's a quick way to keep everyone in sync, keep everyone aware of what's happening, but not taking 20 minutes to discuss timesheets and how much this issue is more complex than you expected. It's supposed to be short and start of the day. Everyone on the same page, and a chance to chat afterwards about what's blocking. Another meeting is sprint planning. So usually at the start of every sprint, we all sit down in the room for an hour or so. So we've looked at all of the issues or stories or whatever you want to call them, pieces of work that need to be done in the short-term future. Someone else has done that, which I'll get to later. And then we say, okay, let's discuss those. How can we solve it? How complex is this going to be? So usually someone goes through, here's what needs to be done, here's why we're doing it. And then we give them, as a group, a complexity ranking. So usually for us, that's a number roughly equating 1 point to 1 day's worth of work. And so we can say, all right, this story here is going to take 5 person days to solve roughly. This one here is going to take 1 day, that sort of thing. Then once we've gone through and ranked a bunch of stories, we say, okay, on average, our team is able to solve 30 complexity points a sprint. Which ones do we want to do? And usually this is where you involve the client. They might say, oh, this thing I wanted, now that I realize it's actually going to take you 60 points worth of work or something, I don't want it anymore. And so it's a way to prioritize based on complexity and the feature. Once we've gotten roughly the amount of points that we solve, we commit to that trust sprint. So, okay, in 2 weeks' time, we're going to have solved all these problems. The other part of one of the main meetings is retrospective, which is after the end of the sprint, you sit down and you talk about what went well and what went badly. For us, when we do it, each person can raise 3 points. Can either be good, bad, or indifferent. So talk about it, everyone puts their ideas up, and we vote, and the top 3 voted comments get talked about in depth. So this is a way of just iterating on the process. There can be meta things, like this team needs to be talked to more, this meeting is going too long, they're taking too much time up, those sorts of things, or it can be directly, this bit of code is really untested and causing us problems, we need to make sure that we're bringing a fix into that next sprint. There's just a way for the team to, I guess, give feedback and iterate on the process. So hopefully when everything's working, you have some very relevant points you're working on for that sprint, daily meetups, and afterwards talk about what went well and how to improve it. The other meetings that we do regularly are one-on-ones, which is us getting a manager for half an hour, and it's a chance for feedback in both directions, for me to say what's working for me and him to give me performance feedback. Also a chance for mentoring kind of thing. Here's how you can improve in the future. So those sort of four meetings are the only meetings in my calendar regularly. And occasionally there's other ones, like if there's a big long story coming up, we might meet to discuss it and talk about it and split it up. But usually it's just the 5 minutes a morning, half an hour once a fortnight, and those 2 hour long meetings a fortnight. So some common pitfalls with an agile process is stand-ups become sit-downs, where every person talks about their timesheet and all the things that went right and all the things that went wrong in the previous day, and suddenly if each person talking for 5 minutes and your team has 10 people on it, that's an hour in the morning gone and nothing achieved. You want to keep that as short and punchy as you can. Another problem people have is taking on too much as a minimum viable project. So we want to do this minimum viable thing you can, let's get something out there, let's get some feedback on it. It's not going to be perfect, it's not going to be polished. If you try and do a fully perfect polished feature, then it's not going to take you 2 weeks, it's going to take you multiple months, and you've lost the benefit of quick iterative feedback. Poor sprint commitment is another one. A lot of people, if you're bad at estimating complexity, you end up with either just picking up a random bunch of issues and never quite completing it, never getting that process done, or the opposite. If you're just picking off random things, you lose that momentum, you lose the focus that that brings. And if you're not involving your customers, then you're also losing all the feedback that this short cycle gives you. So a lot of people I've seen try agile work and say it doesn't work, and usually missing at least one of these things. Because, I mean, at its core, it's really just short amounts of work with regular feedback. That's how we do it at Atlassian. So that's the agile versus waterfall part. Now I want to talk about what does the average team look like in the industry. When you're coding at university, usually it's isolated. Occasionally, towards the end of the degree, it's teamwork. And then in the industry, it's always teamwork. So software is about teams, which is somewhat ironic. It's kind of stereotyped as the industry people go into who don't like people, and they end up working with people exclusively. Everything is team-based. You kind of can't do any real industry-sized project by yourself. So what does the average team makeup look like? So there's kind of a bunch of engineers. There is usually a manager, and there's usually someone in charge of project management, some kind of external interfacing with other teams. I'll talk a little bit about how each of those roles breaks down. Some of the more optional ones you'll see vary from team to team are QAs, which is someone explicitly in charge of quality, or SREs, which is someone in charge of like uptime and maintenance for service stuff. So what does a software engineer role look like? That's probably what most people start their career doing, and some end it, it's perfectly valid, is picking up single tasks of issues and working on them. So at Atlassian, we'll have a issue on our Jira, which is our project management tool, that says we need to make this session key expire longer, or we need this button on the page that does this. Usually it's a fairly short, completely isolated task that I can pick up and I can start working on. I'll go through the full process of that for you guys as part of the tools that we use, because that will change the process. But basically the day is designing, creating, and testing that issue. And you do everything that's involved in getting that from a idea in a piece of paper through to code that's actually running on a customer's computer somewhere. The other main part of the job description will be helping other engineers. So usually you want to bounce ideas off someone, show someone else your code. A lot of my day can be taken up looking at people's code and helping them with their problems as well. So the management side of things can get a little blurry into exactly how it breaks down. Everyone does it a bit differently. But the basic roles that they're doing are the HR side of things. So that's the promotions, discipline, headcounts, all that sort of work. There's also the inter-team discussion. You need someone who can talk to other teams about work they're doing or other parts of the business and sell your idea. In general, you want your engineers to be as isolated as possible. And for me, a sign of a good team is how clueless the engineers are about all of the string pulling on going above them. And so usually there's a manager who tries to take all of that brunt on themselves, let the engineers do their day-to-day coding and worry about budgeting and reviews and all that kind of thing taken up by one person. You also need someone who's a final authority when debates happen, who is the head coder or whatever. And you also need someone who's got a technical input on deciding what you should be working on. Some places will break this, this might be one person. I've seen some places that do the whole technical side, which would be like those two things is one person and the human resources is another person. There's no direct split, everyone tries it differently, but those are the kind of roles that are manager or a team lead will be doing. The other thing is the project manager or a PM, called a BA, business analyst in some spots. So that is the other side of the backlog management, what work's coming up. So they're the ones responsible for talking with clients, communicating upcoming needs, prioritizing what needs to happen, all that sort of work. And they usually have, they're in charge of scheduling. So Atlassian, my team, has both a team lead and a project manager. The team lead's more responsible for technical decisions, and the project manager's responsible for non-technical decisions. And together they form, here's our prioritization list of tasks we work on. The exact line can get blurry, depending on the individuals involved. So those are, usually every software team will have some combination of those things. The other ones that vary team to team is the quality assurance or quality assistance. Now, some places I've worked have a quality assurance department. So that's when you write your code, you send it off to the QA section that runs through a whole bunch of manually scripted tests that are agreed upon with the client, and they come back and show you all the bugs they found. Places go with that. I think it's not a great solution. Atlassian is slightly different. It stands for quality assistance. So on our team, we have one person designated as a QA who's extra responsible for the quality of the code. That being said, the person who knows how to break your code best is you. You wrote it, you know the problems with it, we all know how to find bugs and things. It makes far more sense for you to try and fix it than for someone else to try and find the problem with it. There's a very famous story at Microsoft where they had to meet a certain quota of things completed a day. So people would write deliberately bad code that would then later on get picked up by QA and returned as a bug, and they'd be able to fix it because that gave them more time. That kind of thing does happen in industry, and I think it's very counterproductive. It's much better when you're responsible for the quality of your own code and not waiting on someone else to find your issues. So it's Atlassian is integrated directly with our department. Not everywhere uses this model, so I'll try and talk a bit about both. So usually what will happen with us is before we start working on something, we'll have the quality assurance person or assistant sit with us and say, okay, have you thought about what happens if the dependent services go down? Have you thought about what happens if the data's weirdly formed? Have you thought about the kind of hard questions that you know you should be asking yourself, but when you spend 3 days trying to solve a bug, you kind of forget to. Then once we go through and have this list in our head of things you have to consider, we get to the very end and they sit down with us and they say, okay, show me it works. So usually that's after it's been through all the process before we get merged to the customers, and we go through and they say this and say, okay, what happens if you click it really quickly and don't give it time to load, or just try the kinds of things that tend to break software, and usually it passes, sometimes we find bugs and fix them. They're also responsible at Atlassian. They are developers who work on the team, but they're responsible for the quality side of things, so introducing a new framework, which are real engineering problems. How do you test a system in isolation when we want to test its integration with other systems? It's a hard problem to solve. And so they try and work on solutions to test cross-product and that kind of thing. So yeah, that varies dramatically in different companies, but that's how Atlassian does it. The other thing is an SRE. So any place that's running a service rather than providing a product will have uptime quotas to make sure it's available. We'll have monitoring of metrics and that sort of thing. And SRE is a kind of the middle ground between hardware and software, where they're trying to monitor which servers are running, how do we have load balances working, how do we get this data. When everything breaks at 2 a.m, who's going to be on call to try and fix it? So they're the on-call running systems. It's a fairly new role in a lot of places, and a fairly new term, but it's something that's becoming more and more prevalent across cloud companies. So that's roughly how a software team is structured. We want to talk through exactly which tools that we're using and how that workflow looks. So the first thing I want to talk about is version control. Historically, this hasn't been taught at most universities, and so I wanted to cover a bit here. You need some way to share files when you're working with 5, 6, 10 other developers, to share the files, share the changes. Some systems use locking, where you reserve a file, say I'm making changes and put the file back, and some use merging, where each you write your own code at the same time, and then when you push it, you try and work out who wins and how it works. The other thing version control provides are backups. You have it running somewhere on a server, and it also provides a source of truth. When you want to deliver code to customers, you use the version control, either from your computer or someone else's computer. For version control, I recommend Git. There's many options out there. Git's the only valid one, in my opinion. It's used by every major company. I think except Google, who use their own version of it, that's customized slightly.
Facebook.
Facebook is something different.
Facebook is curious.
there are other versions out there. I'd use Git anyway. It was written by Linus, the guy who wrote Linux, to help manage their huge sprawling kind of database they have. Takes a little bit to get used to, but is great. One of the things I wish someone had told me when I was at university is to learn Git. It's really useful for tracking your projects, for collaborating with other people, for backing ups, for reverting changes that broke things the night before. I would make sure that you research it and look into that one. Practically, and also as a plug, Bitbucket is a product made by Atlassian that is a free online Git host, including a tutorial on how to use Git. Perfect for storing assignments. And then one of the nicest things about Git, I won't go into a full Git tutorial here, there's other things online for that, but you make changes in increments and then you can revert those changes. So when you do break something up before, you can just say, I want to go back to this version of the code, and all that stuff's for free. It's also got very nice merging for team projects. SourceTree is a free local client that helps abstract away some of the complexities of Git. I use a command line personally and just type in all the commands manually, but I know SourceTree is very popular and useful. And Atlassian is very heavily on Bitbucket for all our projects. The ones that aren't are on a thing called Stash, which is basically Bitbucket for behind the firewall stuff rather than online and cloud. Is it still called Stash?
It's called Bitbucket Server.
Okay. Both Bitbucket then. Should have called that when you were looking at the slides. So yeah, I would look into those things personally. I wish someone told me that when I was at uni. How the average workflow looks when I'm writing code is the very first thing I do is get the most updated version of the codebase. Then I split off that my local machine and write my code, write all my changes. Once I've done that, I push it to the server. So the server now has the actual code that it considers to be source of truth and my weird version of it. I then ask a colleague or multiple to look at the difference between those two things. So there's a nice UI that shows you here's what was added, here's what was removed. They can write comments, I can respond with comments. This is called a pull request. You see that terminology used. And it's a nice way to have someone more senior give advice and feedback. Once the pull request is accepted and everyone's happy with it, in the meantime, we have a server running our automated tests, which I'll talk about later. Once the automated tests have passed and someone on my team has approved the code is okay, then the code gets merged in, all my changes become integrated with the main branch, and that automatically gets released to our internal development all the way to customers. And that's kind of the average life cycle of code. Pull requests are intimidating when you first start looking at these kind of complex workflows. Particularly at Atlassian, the engineers are forthcoming with advice, and it can be very intimidating to write your first piece of code and have 100 comments on there on how to improve it. But it's also a very good way to learn and a good way to make sure the quality stays high of your code base. This is also what's used for most open source projects, if you're contributing to those. There'll be an owner who owns a repository, people will make suggestions in a pull request, and the owner can choose to merge those in or to reject them. So I mentioned we have automatic testing and running. This is where we use Bamboo, which is another one of our products that we sell. It is runs builds on certain conditions. So it will run relatively complex scripts that can run all of our integration tests between products by bringing up entire online cloud instances and running tests, or it can run very basic unit tests. And then once that's been approved, it can make new Git branches. Like kind of anything workflowy running scripts you need, it's good at. It can also prevent merges from being made until the tests agree. So no one's allowed to merge in a broken test to our code bases. So that's what that product does. Probably overkill for what university needs are, but in industry, you're looking for something to automatically deploy code to customers that automatically run tests. It's quite a good tool. So that's our coding, version control, build tools. The collaboration side of things, I'm going to talk about how that looks on a day-to-day basis. So the first one is Jira. Jira is Atlassian's best known product, in my opinion. It's probably our biggest one. It's used for tracking tasks through a workflow as a very high-level overview. What that means for software is we track issues. A particular bug gets created, and then the bug goes from there to needing to be confirmed by someone. Then once it's confirmed, it goes to in development, and kind of have this whole workflow. It goes into in pull requests, requiring QA demos. And so you can track this task through this entire life cycle. Here was the SLA agreements, all that kind of business logic. It's what we use for all of our individual issues, what we use for tracking our larger stories and how to break them up into smaller tasks. It's what we use for our sprint planning. When we say, here's what we're committing to. We say, here's 2 weeks worth of work, here's how much it's going to take, and we can watch it. We also have a nice big board on the wall that shows you where each issue from the current sprint's up to, whether it's in review, whether it's merged in, or whether it's waiting to be done, so you can kind of see how the whole thing's progressing. So that's one of the industry standard tools for tracking workflows. It's very customizable and can be scary when you first start. It's a huge product, but very good, and I'd recommend at least looking into it. It's used in a lot of like NASA and all the other places where I'm working. Confluence is another product that we make and use very heavily at Atlassian. And the idea is it's kind of like a wiki. So you upload all your documentation. It kind of replaces emailing. When you want to email a file to someone or a new starter, you say instead, go to this Confluence space. And this has our starting documentation. It has all of our onboarding processes. It has all of the HR guidelines and policies. So it's this kind of highly available, editable document. People can upload their files and it saves trying to search through your hard drive and email things around. We also use it heavily internally for blog posting. So all sorts of announcements of features or of new arrivals or kind of things. There's a whole workflow, sorry, a whole page full of here are all the announcements you need to be reading, as well as here's all the documentation you need to find. So it's kind of between Jira tracking all our issues and Confluence tracking documentation. Those two spots have all the data that we use most days. HipChat is the other tool that gets used very heavily at Atlassian, and again, one of the ones we make. We kind of make all the tools that we use. It's a chat tool, like MSN Messenger or something, or Facebook, Google Hangouts, but designed for enterprises. So it has rooms, or people can join one room. So my team has a room to discuss things, or one-on-one chats to discuss topics. Between this and Confluence, we've kind of killed email. We very rarely get emails now. If you're direct communication, you use this tool, or for sharing documents, you use Confluence. And it saves hunting through emails to see who's replied to what and how to organize things. I recommend this tool for working in teams and trying to communicate. I guess at university, Facebook chat works fine, but for a larger organization, I'd consider looking into this when you do go into workplace and that kind of thing. So those are the tools and processes that we use here. I'm out of time. Smashing through it. And I just had a little bit to talk about what Atlassian was like, and I thought I'd open up for questions afterwards. So I think I talked to most of you today at the careers fair, these kinds of things. I'll go through it quickly. But basically, to me, the most important cultural things that make Atlassian different from the other software places I've worked or heard about is, first of all, the company values actually matter. I remember being in a few places and reading the company values that are on the board behind the reception and thinking, has anyone ever read those and changed their decision based on it? Here, I have actively pointed out to people that the decision you're making violates this value, and they've stopped and thought about it and changed their decision. It's that kind of, you can actually use this as a way of discussing things, or changing things, or justifying things. They're all over the website, I won't go into too much, but it's things like put the customer first, and work with heart and balance, make sure your life balance is okay. There's a whole five values that really define who Atlassian is, and those are actually lived out. The other thing is, ideas and disruption are welcome. I have seen meetings, like departmental meetings, 50 people in it. They've announced a strategy that's coming up for the next quarter, and someone stood up, put their hand up and said, I think that's a really bad idea and we shouldn't do it. And that was entirely welcome and encouraged for people to give honest and actual feedback, even in public settings. I think a lot of people claim they want to be able to have anyone contribute ideas, but in reality don't trust you with that. I think Atlassian, and to me what makes it really special, is they seek out your ideas and evaluate them on their merit. That's also terrifying when I joined and I thought I was smart, and I came up with an idea and it got shot down in flames correctly because they found all these problems with it. But I learned from that process rather than not being able to say anything and doing something I thought was wrong. Another thing I really like is you're given the resources you need to succeed. In particular, the CEOs were software engineers themselves, so you're given a top-of-the-line machine with multiple screens and all the keyboards you need, standing desks. So both like hardware resources, and you're also given access to people that you need. I've had a lot of places ask you to complete a task and don't give you the freedom to get what you need, whereas you can spend money and can do things here. Colleagues you respect, for me, is a big one. The hiring bar at Atlassian is fairly high for a good reason, and anyone on my team I would trust to do any issue. There's no sort of hierarchy of you're not really good, so we'll give you the small task, or you're brand new, so we'll give you something small. Everyone's able to pick up most things and able to contribute even to products they aren't regularly a part of. I recently put in a bug fix for a long-standing issue on a completely different product, and everyone was okay with that, with me making changes. Sorry, I've been a bit sick this week. And the other thing, and the final thing I wanted to highlight, is it feels like a small company. It's growing rapidly. It's now 2,000 people worldwide in 40 different offices, but the bureaucracy is very low. And I think a large part of that is due to Confluence. Because everyone's posting what their team's working on, and everyone's blogging about it, and everyone's, all of the policies are clearly there for everyone to see and comment on, it makes all that bureaucracy a lot harder. No one's keeping you out of the loop on emails. It's written there for you to find if you want it. So minimal bureaucracy, able to get in contact people you need to talk to. It's kind of, it's removed a lot of the big bureaucratic feeling from companies, and it feels small.